afternoon. My name is Brittany Ann Montoro. I'm a senior music theory composition major, and I would love to present my research on Erik Satie, the pioneer of the avant-garde in modern music. The avant-garde was an important movement in art, literature, and music of France from 1870 to 1930. It was a negative reaction, against the trends found in the German romanticism and aestheticism of Richard Wagner, which had been very prevalent in Europe in the late Romantic era. Erik Satie aligned himself with the avant-garde movement, or unconventional movement, and was the first composer to separate himself from tonality and Wagner's influence in history. His controversial compositions contributed to the avant-garde movement. With the intent of improving music pedagogy and performance, the purpose of the research is to examine the avant-garde movement in music and its relationship to Erik Satie. I analyzed the historical and cultural developments from 1870 through 1930 in France. Then I analyzed early 20th century French music. Then I examined the life of Satie and his influence on the avant-garde. And then I analyzed, and I will play for you today, the Je m'appelle number one, the Nocienne number three, Vexations, Sport et Divertissement, and Parade in terms of style, philosophy, and compositional techniques. My first problem, I address the historical and cultural developments that occurred in France from 1870 through 1930, the first of which being the art movement known as Impressionism. Impressionism is an art movement known for the distortion of clarity in a realistic image and shading of color, which makes what is real practically unrecognizable. It was a negative term coined by critics at an exhibition of art for Claude Monet's Sunrise, Impression, Sunrise, in 1874. Also, Impressionism as an art form was attributed to musicians such as Claude Debussy and Maurice Ravel, who, though are considered to be modern musicians, are not the first historical modern musicians. That I will get to Satie later on in the presentation. In the literary world in France, we have symbolism, which was practically the literary equivalent of impressionism. It was known for the breakdown of traditional poetry and prose to suggest an idea rather than interpret it realistically. In two poets in particular, Paul Rolland and Stéphane Mallarmé, were known for their contributions to symbolism. And Mallarmé's poem, The Prelude to the Afternoon of the Faun, was set to music by the modern musician Claude Debussy for an orchestral arrangement with beautiful chords and exceptional use of dissonance and unconventional atonality. The third movement that occurred in France at this time was the Dada movement. It was an art movement known for the destruction, complete obliteration of all traditional forms of literature, art, and music to promote the spontaneous and the illogical. So if it was unconventional as it could get, it was Dada. In Paris in 1920, Tristan Tzara, who was known for his contribution to the Dada movement when it began in Zurich, Switzerland, at the Cabaret Voltaire Club, facilitated a practice called sound poetry, which was the collection of cacophonic or discordant sounds put together either with handmade, ready-made objects, or even discordant syllables and voices, and put together to create noise, which was the antithesis to something that was pleasing, and to the overt, elaborate nature of Romanticism. The fourth movement that occurred in France at the time was an outgrowth of Dada, and that was Surrealism. It had its spark in 1924 with the writer André Breton, and he had a quote in his particular Manifesto of Surrealism, "So strong is the belief in life that in the end the belief is lost." Such harsh words that were used to characterize the modern age so that he could portray the unreal and the subconscious mind, and that people could analyze deeper into themselves and figure out what was harsher or what was more uncomfortable about oneself and display it through art. The second problem that I encountered was music in France during the early 20th century. From 1600 to 1900, the reign of tonality is here. Traditional major and minor tonalities are prevalent between the Baroque classical and Romantic eras. And in the late Romantic era, we have experimentation from French composers, two in particular, Gabriel Fauré and Emmanuel Chabrier. They were known for their unusual progressions in their mixing of major and minor tonalities, in addition to Gregorian modes, which had not been utilized since the medieval era. Within this, non-functional harmony. To demonstrate non-functional harmony, functional harmony is harmony that, quote unquote, makes sense to our ear, something which is tonal. So we'll hear a pretty song like, which sounds very pleasing, up until when you get to non-functional harmony, which is a pushing of the boundary of the rules, where you have, major and minor is starting to get suspended at this point in history. Following these two French composers, we have Claude Debussy and Maurice Ravel, which were considered to be musical impressionists through their use of shading and color and unconventional practices of music. Debussy in particular used modality and exoticism. Exoticism is the borrowing of non-traditional modes from other cultures, such as Japan and the use of their modes, and Asian gamelan music. Ravel also used non-functional harmony, but he incorporated it with traditional American jazz. And especially, he had used this American jazz in the piano concerto, which my professor, Noemi Otto, played in the Impressionism recital this past January. These composers also utilized chords of addition. So if I go back to the piano and show you my nice, pretty C major chord, our nice tonal chord, and then we want to add on to that chord and make it non-traditional. I've just stacked thirds on top of thirds, but I have broken traditional tertian or third-based harmony as a result. And that is a chord of addition. The third problem is how Eric Satie fit into the picture historically and was the catalyst for these events and his influence on the French avant-garde. He was born in Honfleur, France on May 17, 1866, to his father Alfred Satie and Jane Leslie Anton. He was baptized a Protestant. After the Franco-Prussian War in 1871, his father sold his shipbroking practice and had to bring the family to Paris to seek better work. His mother's death in 1872 provoked Satie to move back to Honfleur and become a Catholic at the discretion of his grandparents, Alfred's parents, who had wanted him to convert. And as a result of his conversion to Catholicism, it influenced him musically when he studied organ and Gregorian chant under Vino in 1874 at the Church of St. Leonard. His knowledge of music, especially Gregorian chant, will serve him later on in his career. After his grandmother's death in 1878, he reunited with his father in Paris, who had remarried a salon pianist and teacher named Eugénie Bartonèche, and would continue his music studies there in Paris. While in Paris, for a year before he had went to the Paris Conservatory in 1879, he studied on the French organ composer Félix-Alexandre Guimond. When he entered the Paris Conservatory in 1879, he didn't exactly enjoy his studies. And if any of you who have ever taken a class at college or are currently in college right now, like myself, there are some professors you don't like, there are some people you will run into who will make your life crazy, and there are some places you will live that you will not always enjoy.